Welcome to the Rebel Love Show. We are a once-a-week broadcast from Manchester, New Hampshire, where we are pro-pot, pro-gun, and pro-coffee. We are syndicated on Voluntary Virtues Network. We're also on iTunes and Stitcher, as well as YouTube. And also go find us at rebelloveshow.com. I am Rob Mathias.
And I am Shire Dude.
And today we have a special guest, part of the... It's like this too show, none other than Cecelia Fairchild.
Hello, kittens.
Well, hello.
Hey.
So, it's like this too. How would you come up with the name?
Funny story.
Actually, yeah, the guy who came up with the name is in the room, right?
Well,
what, Riaz?
Riaz came up with it. Yeah,
because he loves that hashtag.
Yeah, like he came up with it, and then I thought about it, and I was like, that's brilliant because people are already using It's Like This Too as a hashtag. So every time they hashtag it, they'll be promoting us.
Yeah, right? But the hashtag actually came from that line of memes that happened.
Yeah, well, yeah.
That were put out by the Free State Project. And that's where the hashtag came from. And then that, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Wait, there's a Free State, that's a Free State Project meme.
Isn't it? I thought it was.
Yeah, like they put the hashtag It's Like This Too.
Like,
I just thought it was a popular hashtag.
That's a Free State Project one specifically. Like, if you look on the Free State Project Facebook page.
Like, there's a picture of him doing, like, this kind of face because he's in a gas station that accepts Bitcoin and he's open carrying. And it's like New Hampshire. Or when you walk in, blah, 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 New Hampshire, it's like this, too. You know, when you walk into a gas station that accepts Bitcoin open carrying, you know, it's like this, too.
I was at that gas station and I filmed Neil Connor. All right. Here's this gay guy who is open carrying a pistol, all right, and buying gas with Bitcoin in front of, like, a bunch of, like, liberty literature in the background, like messages on the wall and stuff like that, while there's a little girl staring at him.
And what does she say?
She's like, "Mister, why do you have a gun?" And, like, he looks at her in, like, the most calm and, like, professional way, and he says, "Well, you know, just like how you have insurance on a car or a lock on your front door, you know, this is just my protection, my insurance, and it's just here to protect me." And he said it in such a, like, a professional, like, nice way, and the girl was like, "Oh, okay," and she walked away. It was like this beautiful little moment that I somehow captured. It was like, it literally was It's Like This Too.
Neil should be doing elementary school outreach, like, on the regular.
For open carrying.
Definitely.
Yeah. Open carry at elementary schools.
Outside elementary schools.
Yeah.
He
would do great at it. He really should do it.
Second Amendment tots. You can use the name. I just gave it to you.
He needs to just quit the Foundation for New Hampshire Independence and just do open carry at elementary schools, because he can pull it off. You don't believe me?
I'm very amused by this right here, what's going on. It's like you're one person but separated because you're just finishing each other's sentences.
It's kind of...
It's adorable.
We're having a moment.
This dynamic is adorable.
Oh, thank you.
We try.
Speaking,
it's very hard to find a good dynamic when you do a show. It is.
And I feel like I found that with us in our new show.
Oh, thanks.
Like, we have a really good dynamic on It's Like This Too.
We all have our own little jobs.
Yeah.
It's like we share him.
Can you give, like, the kind of, like...
You are not my metamorph. No.
Oh, man.
There's none of this.
Can you give, like, the elevator pitch for It's Like This Too real fast for people who haven't seen it?
The elevator pitch?
Yeah.
If you're going to do it.
Yeah, because we haven't really, like, said the format, you know?
Okay, essentially, it's just a glimpse into the lives of early movers for the Free State Project and what they're doing to exert, I'm going to quote the statement of intent for the Free State Project, to exert their fullest practical effort towards the creation of a society where the maximum role of government is to protect life, liberty, and property. So essentially, it's like many documentaries where we're just talking to people about what they're doing, the activisms, whether they're doing, you know, like, free living, the projects they're working on, so that folks who may not know what's going on in the Free State Project, don't know about the Free State Project, or maybe know of it but don't know what it's like here, can get a glimpse of what's going on. And predominantly right now, we're trying to talk to people who aren't necessarily in the spotlight all the time. You know what I mean?
So who have you interviewed that's not in the spotlight?
Well, the next episode that will be coming out Monday, as long as someone finishes editing.
Is CeeLo.
It will be Christopher Lopez.
Not Christopher.
Christopher.
Chris Lopez.
I'm drunk.
Oh,
no,
man.
Chris Lopez, who is...
CeeLo.
CeeLo,
yeah,
as we affectionately call her. That's how all the files are named on my computer.
Me too.
it's on my phone, too. Anyways, she is the admin for the Free State Project, so she does all of, like, the...
Welcome letters.
Well, Will you shut your face and let me talk? Jesus Hubert goodness. So she's basically like the face of the Free State Project as far as participants and new movers goes. She sends welcome letters to people who sign the statement of intent. When people are interested in visiting New Hampshire, she gets them connected with folks that are already here so they can do meetups and, you know, see the sites, see the areas. She gets them in contact, excuse me, for people who are, you know, she does basically all the interactions between Free State Project and potential people. Yes,
she gives people their mover numbers.
She does.
She actually was the one who tattooed Joel's new mover number.
No, she did.
Yeah, she did. Yeah. He has a video of it.
Yeah, they did it like prison tattoo style. It was pretty epic.
No.
He had a bite down on a watermelon slice.
No, I watched the Shire Dude video of Desert Lynx getting a tattoo, and that is not how it happened. Incorrect.
You notice how he's the only one that has done that.
Yes.
So far. Are there any other mover number tattoos out there? I'd be really interested to find one.
I'm surprised that someone who moved here after the first 1,000 would even get their mover number tattooed on them.
Oh, snap.
I'm just saying.
What's your mover number?
What is your mover number?
930.
Oh, okay.
Oh, really?
Wow.
Yeah.
I figured it'd be like 90.
No, God. Chris Lopez is 50.
CeeLo's mover number 50.
Yeah, okay. And she would move here in 2006.
I figured
it'd
be at least the top 500. I thought you were here a hell of a lot longer. 9:30? No. That's like
in Shire time though. It is a long time.
That is a long time in Shire time. How many Shire years have you been here?
Well, carry the 12. A decade. But real years, it's just over 3 years.
That's about a decade in Shire time. Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah,
particularly when you add in libertarian time on top of that.
is that like a wild card multiplier? Like it's just.
I guess there's like normal time, like there's Eastern Standard Time. Like if you say we're gonna go to the movies or we're gonna go have dinner at 5 o'clock, most people would show up around 5 o'clock. 5 o'clock, libertarians show up around 5:30, 5:45. Yep.
Yeah.
Libertarians are not very good at being on time.
We're not good with math or telling time. Words are hard sometimes.
Words are hard for everyone, though.
Like my birthday party tomorrow is actually, the movie's not going to start until 9:45, but I told everyone 9:15 so that everyone will be there by 9:45.
Totally going to show up at 9:45.
Don't you do it.
I went to go buy tickets to that, and it was sold out.
No, you don't have to buy tickets. We reserve the whole theater.
Oh.
I am smart. I reserve the whole theater, and we actually get a cheaper price.
Tell the audience what we're seeing.
We're seeing The Hunger Games: Mockingjay Part 1.
Nice.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I didn't know you reserved the whole theater.
Yeah.
That means I need to watch both Hunger Games movies tonight.
There's apparently a marathon going on right now.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Okay. And you're missing it. Yeah. I guess you're going to have to rewatch the marathon. How did you not see the Hunger Games?
I've been busy making Liberty content.
No, that came out years. That came out before you moved. What were you doing in California before,
Well, I was doing Liberty on the Rock. So actually, yeah, I was still doing.
He was yelping. He was yelping.
Yeah, you yelp way too much.
I started yelping,
It's Liberty Outreach.
I put the app on my phone and I started yelping. I started checking in places.
Mm-hmm.
I checked into Skinny's the other day.
Definitely. Don't try to get Skinny's away from me.
And I checked into Savaki.
80 something check-ins.
I have not had that yet.
What? Savaki?
Yeah, I've not had that
yet.
You
are missing out.
That's the word on the street.
Oh my God, it's so good.
You want to find the really good food in Manchester, hang out with Riaz or Cecilia or a combination of the two. Because they find the gems.
Riaz needs to start some sort of Shire food critics blog where he just has rates all the places that he goes. Mm-hmm. I'm serious, because he's always eating out. I don't think he even knows how to use like a kitchen.
A stove.
Yeah. He does. He eats out a lot.
Putting him on a blast right now. He doesn't even have a microphone. Come on now.
He's just sitting over there sconing on his phone. Like, fuck you people.
Sconing?
I'm going to make fun of you later. Oh, so.
What the
you
hell
know
is sconing?
I know what cupcaking is.
Okay, so good.
Is that like cupcaking leveled up or something?
Do you know what cupcaking is, right?
Yeah, explain it to the audience,
I
though.
So cupcaking is when you are on your phone and you're like messaging your sweetheart, the person you're either seeing, fucking, whatever, and you're just doing cutesy messages when you're in a group of people around other people you could actually be physically interacting with. That's called cupcaking because it's sweet. Sconing is a term that myself and Antigone Darling came up with because it's less sweet. So you're just on your phone doing shit when you're in a room full of people who you could be socializing with. So it's sconing. He's a big sconer.
What do you call it when you just look at the price of Bitcoin constantly on your phone?
Darren Tap.
Tapping?
Tapping.
Can we call it tapping? Tapping out.
Bitcoin Darren.
Does he do that?
You know what's really funny? That game, that Bitcoin game I told you about, you have to tap to mine Bitcoins. Oh my God.
We've had Darren Tap on the show, right?
Yeah, he was great on the show. Yeah. He loves Bitcoin.
Yeah, he does. He does. We're gonna interview him.
You should.
Oh. Other people, yeah.
On It's Like This Too, we'll have him on there.
All the people.
Yeah.
I'm really, and
if you guys, audience, if you don't have Bitcoin yet, Darren's gonna tell you why you gotta get it.
You gotta get that.
You
Bitcoin.
Gotta get Bitcoin.
Oh, hey, so Shire Dude, if people wanted to watch our show, where would they do that?
The Free State Project YouTube is probably the easiest way to find it.
I think it's Free State NH on there. I don't know. You're the one that uploads it. I'm just here to look pretty.
Shouldn't you guys know where the YouTube videos are at? Like, well, we're throwing it up somewhere. I mean, we don't really know the URL, but it's
hosted on there. It's hosted on Voices of Liberty, which is Ron Paul's new channel.
And every week when we publish an episode, I post it on freestateproject.org.
Yes. Actually, freestateproject.org is probably the...
Go to freestateproject.org.
Yeah, does the actual official website get any traffic?
It does now.
I wouldn't. Boom.
Now that there's content on it.
Right.
I honestly don't know. I don't have access to the analytics.
Okay.
I'm on the fringe right now. We're taking over though.
Pretty much.
Slowly, we're taking over.
The last time I looked at that website was when I signed the intent to move. I haven't looked at it since.
Wow.
that was almost 2 years ago.
Well, for example.
No, 3 years ago. Something like that.
On the Friday before we posted our first episode, we did an announcement blog, and then we posted our first two episodes. All three of those posts are right next to each other on the Free State Project blog, or the website. Now, then between the second episode and the third episode, there's like five things.
Right.
So in 2 weeks, there was nothing in between what we were doing, and then in 1 week, there was like a whole bunch of things. So maybe it's just weaning away like that. I don't know, but I think there's plans to have more content generation.
Oh, everyone's talking about content, especially after 101 Reasons came out.
Oh, my God. They're so inspirational.
Yeah. Great movie. Absolutely great movie. I hope it gets, hopefully Pendulette pimps it out a little bit more.
Mm-hmm. That's 101reasonsfilm.com.
I didn't know Daryl was here.
So when are you going to... Because you did podcasts somewhat in the past, back in the heyday of Kane.
Correct.
When are you gonna start up Ladies of Manch?
Oh, good Lord! actually, this is a funny story. So, have you ever met Cody O'Connor and Melinda
B? Of course.
B?
Yes. Okay. Yes.
Love
them. Yeah, they're absolutely amazing.
They're great.
Cody needs to move here, by the way.
So they intend.
Wait, hold on, Cody. I know you listen to this podcast. You don't watch this on YouTube, so I don't know why I'm pointing at the camera. But nonetheless, get your ass to Manch. You can just visit. You're fucking made. Get down here. All right, continue.
That's not helping. They've already said that they're moving to New Hampshire. They intend
No. Melinda is dead set on not moving here.
No. Listen.
I listened to Off the Air Live. She is
even,
not fucking
no,
moving here.
No, they have made an agreement with me that when I move to Manchester, they will move to Manchester. This is their statement of intent.
Oh, that's true. Yeah, I almost forgot about that.
And Melinda and I have agreed that when this happens, we will have our own podcast together. And the tentative name for it is Liberty Vagina Hour.
That sounds like a good show. I would listen to it.
It's very important to let people know that you're a woman right up front. Because tits are GTFO.
So I need to know, when are you going to trigger the Cody and Melinda move?
In the near distant future.
Right, so we have to trigger Cecilia's move to trigger the Cody Melinda.
Well, what's gonna take us to trigger the Cecilia move?
Yeah.
A fantastic paying job in my chosen field.
What's your chosen field?
The bowling industry.
Just
don't laugh
just
at my livelihood.
I know. It's just.
Well, I don't laugh at your silly video editing.
I just
and your Shire Dude videos.
Yes, you do. Of course you do. We all laugh.
Because they're hilarious.
Yep. But the reason I'm laughing is because I was imagining someone listening to the podcast and like expecting, you know, all these different industries, and bowling industry is not at the top of that list.
Just you know what you should do? Start an Agra's bowling, like, the, you know.
Agora no. Alley.
Agora Alley. There you go. Agora Alley.
The two of you, just, you're done. You're both drunk. Go home.
Well, well, we got to get you here somehow because we need to get Cody and Melinda here.
Oh, so the only benefit of getting me here is Cody and Melinda?
That's like top five.
Yeah. It's a win-win.
Oh man.
So I did, while we have you on the show, I did want to talk about one thing. On our last episode, we talked with Brett and Allie about dating within the community.
Oh, good Lord.
And I know you have some experience with that. I was just wondering, like, what do you think about that? Just in general, you can go anywhere you want.
What's your recommendations to the internet at large?
Yeah,
about it?
For the people who haven't moved yet, should they come here expecting romance within the community?
if you know that you have Asperger's, you should fix that, because that's not going to help. no, but in all seriousness, don't try to force things. Be able to read signals, because generally if someone's not interested, they'll be pretty upfront with it, at least by their, you know, their words, their body language. Don't rush into things. Remember that you are within the community, and people do know things. All the people know things. Everybody likes to know everybody's business.
Yeah, pretty much.
As far as like relationships go within like liberty type people, definitely have a lot of conversations, and communication is important in any relationship. So there's that. And try not to be a douchebag during the breakup, because you don't want to shit where you eat.
Yeah, and the community is not big enough where you can just like go away. You're going to run into these people for a very, very, very long time.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I mean, you could try moving to a different city. That might work.
Yeah, you should. That's a good idea. You should do that.
Oh, peace be upon you.
Oh, man.
So you would say possibly if it's right, you should do it.
What, dating within the community? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Oh, definitely. If you feel that you are interested in this person and this person is interested in you, fucking go for it. Don't ever deny yourself happiness because you're afraid of something that could be something that could happen down the line that's probably not going to happen, or it's very unlikely. Don't just shoot yourself in the foot. Don't do that.
Okay, I can get behind that.
Do what you want.
So, you still live in Keene.
Mm-hmm.
First off, why?
That's where I moved initially.
Okay, well, I obviously you're there because of some sort of job, but you don't seem happy. Not that I'm against the Keeniacs. Apparently, I think you are. But what? But why are you still there? What's really holding you back?
My job.
Is it really just your job?
Really, I really like my job.
Because you seem to be here all the time.
I do that. Yeah. Well, between you know, all the cool people that are out here. Particularly people who are behind me on the couch. I don't know about you two. no, I'm kidding. And then doing the show with Shire Dude over here, you know, I do end up being here like 2 to 3 days a week.
That's a lot of commuting.
Correct.
Yeah.
I'm okay
so,
with it.
Okay, well, you do have a lot of history in Keene. Mm-hmm. You've been there a long time. I need to know your take on it. What is your take on the Free Keene Squad? For those that don't know, the FreeKeene Squad apparently somehow is made up of Garrett, Robin Hood, James Cleveland, and Chris Cantwell, who somehow ended up on the Colbert Report last night.
So we're going to talk about these people individually, because that's what they are.
No, well, they're a squad.
They're a squad.
I mean, you even have the Anarcho. What was it? What was?
Afroist.
Thank you, Afroist.
My favorite part of the entire Colbert Report segment is the fact that they named Cantwell the enforcer, which is what Stop Free Keene refers to him as.
Wow.
They refer to him as the enforcer. They call him Ian's enforcer.
I didn't even know that. I haven't really been paying much attention to Stop Free Keene.
Is it a conspiracy? Did someone from Stop Free Keene get a job with Colbert?
That seems unlikely.
It's a conspiracy.
Oh, good Lord. So I don't necessarily morally object to activities that happen in Keene, activisms, et cetera, et cetera. I oppose the attitude and the way in which they engage with people in general. There are some people who are bigger offenders of this than others. I prefer to try to be nice to people, just because I like to change hearts and minds. That's something that I'm into. I like doing outreach, I like talking to people, changing people's minds in the community. Like, I realize that even if 20,000 people move here, that we're still going to need help from those who are already here.
Yeah.
In order to make any real practical change.
There definitely needs to be more outreach to people that already live here. A lot of us seem to do outreach like this, where it's reaching out to get more people here, like this show, or it's like this too, or whatnot. Because you're not, it's not, it's like this too, is not outreach to the like people that live here. It is outreach to, you know, the people on the internet that move here.
The other facet of It's Like This Too that I haven't really talked about, and I don't even know if I've really talked about this with Andrew, the original idea that I had that I talked to Carla Garrick about, because she's the one who got me in touch with the Voices of Liberty guy, because they wanted to do something in conjunction with the Free State Project. And Carla, when I brought my idea to her, just wanting some feedback, she suggested that I talk to him because they were wanting something like my idea. Part of what I wanted to do was kind of to humanize Free Staters, because in New Hampshire, they can kind of be villainized sometimes. You know, if one person who identifies as a Free Stater is an asshole to someone or does something that someone doesn't like, that person then paints that not only that person, but the entire project as the same thing, as an asshole or douchebag or whatnot. And this tends to be my issue with folks who engage in the FreeKeene blog and all of that stuff. They kind of act like a douche. People think they're douche, and then they don't like them. And they associate that with everyone. And I'm not a douche. I'm a really nice, friendly person. And the people that I know within the community know that I'm a nice person. I'm very rational. And I've improved their opinion of folks in the Free State and even some Free Keeners just by my former association with them, just friends and whatnot, because I never did the FreeKeene stuff.
Do you ever meet someone and have fun like coming out as a Free Stater?
It's always interesting. I love seeing people's reactions. Like, I've been working at the same place all three years I've lived here. I got the job before I moved up, and so a lot of the bowlers know that I'm a Free Stater. Like, it was pretty big deal, you know, when I first got here. I had a state cop yell at me from the first couple of weeks that I was there. He was a bowler, and he was like, "Tell me what you Free Staters believe." And I was like, "I'm not doing this right now."
Wow.
But it's always interesting to see how they react. More times than not, I get the, "What's that?" when I tell people that I've moved for the Free State Project. They don't know what it is. And then when I tell them it's just an effort to get 20,000 Liberty Mind people to move to New Hampshire, they're like, "Oh, that's really cool. Well, why is that?" Well, New Hampshire was chosen because it's already really free. Yeah, it is. So that's really cool. But people who tend to have the bad taste in their mouth because of FreeKeene, because most of the people I interact with are in Keene, you know, they're like, "Oh, you're a Free Stater? Really? You seem normal." You know, like, okay.
What advice would you give people on coming out of the closet as a Free Stater?
Be prepared to deal with the consequences.
Like what?
People could be really positive about it, or people could be really negative about it. I've had people yell at me, like I just told you. I had a state cop yell at me, you know.
Well, state cops, come on. Like, states are always going to yell. I've only had two interactions with stateies, and every time it's been absolutely horrible.
He wasn't even, like, working. He was just there bowling. It was weird. It wasn't like he was in uniform. That would have been scary. I would have been like, "Whoa, sir, you need to back up off."
Did you scream at him and say, "Shiny badges don't grant extra rights"?
No, I just went, "I'm going to keep cleaning now." Well, I'd heard stories about him beating the shit out of people. I didn't want to engage in that.
Yeah.
What was I talking about?
Advice to Free Staters coming out of the closet as Free Staters.
I don't know. Just be prepared to deal with the consequences. Be prepared to answer a lot of questions, to have a lot of assumptions made. I had a coworker who started coming to me with all this chemtrail stuff, and I'm like, "Dude, I do not believe in chemtrails." Like, he just, because I was a Free Stater, he thought I would care about this. He's like, "Look at all these chemtrails." I'm like, "Dude, I don't even talk to me with that crazy mess." I don't even.
So Do you come out specifically, or do you wait till people, like, you've been in the same job for a while, but mm-hmm. I take it you have social interactions with other people that live here and whatnot. Do you wait till them to kind of figure it out and come to you, or do you just, like, when do you just straight up come out of the closet? Oh, by the way, I moved here for the FSP.
The first one, generally it goes along the lines of something. They say something that someone who's lived in New Hampshire a long time should know. And I go, I'm sorry, you know, I've only lived here for a couple years. Oh, where are you from? Ohio. Oh, Ohio. Why'd you move to New Hampshire?
Yeah, you always get that one. Well, especially, especially me telling people I came from California. They're like, why would you leave California for New Hampshire?
You're way out of the closet at work, it seems.
Yeah.
So, like, how did you do that? I remember you saying a story pretty early that
I got a
you
story,
told
yeah,
them that
with
they
my,
were a free stater.
With my manager, it was pretty funny. I stayed in the closet for a little while with my manager just because, you know, you don't want any, like, stress between upper management and whatnot. And I told her one day, I was like, hey, you know, my buddy just got his Free State Project mover number tattooed. And then I explained what the Free State Project was. And she's like, oh, I know what the Free State Project is. And I looked at her for a while and I was like, do you know I'm a Free Stater? And she's like, yeah, I've seen your bumper stickers. And she was like totally cool with it. So that's probably like the best possible way that could have went.
I actually have the first time I came out at work as a Free Stater, which was my old job, which I quit, thankfully, last month. I got asked by my assistant manager at the time, because I was managing a retail store. She asked me about Garrett and FreeKeene.
Oh, man.
And I'm like, holy shit, you're asking me about FreeKeene right now. Like, and this is up in, like, Guilford, New Hampshire. This is, like up by Laconia. Or this isn't, like, you know, around here or anything like that. And now, mind you, she's kind of been, she this is, like, 5 months in. So she had been kind of, like, putting details together a little bit. I would drop hints because she would ask me, like, well, what did you do? What do you do? How did you get here? I was like, oh, I know people. Like, I'll be very vague. I was always really vague when she was asking me what my life is like outside. Like, I was like, oh, I kind of write, and I, you know, I do some video and photos or something. I don't know. I kind of travel around the state, which I do. I go to Keene. I'll go out to the coast, and, you know, I'll go to meetups and stuff like that. And, and we would have kind of sometimes, you know, we work long nights and we'd be by ourselves. We kind of get on a philosophical talk a little bit. So we kind of talk about, like, you know, what freedom is and stuff like that a couple times. Somehow she put two and two together. And she started asking me about FreeKeene and Robin Hooding. And no, it wasn't Robin Hooding. No, it was the Chalk Wars. The Chalk Wars,
oh, man,
is what outed me at work.
Dude, she probably Googled you.
You know what?
It's a thing.
Oh, I actually, no, let me tell you something.
No, before you do this, since we're doing story time, I'll tell you about when I came out at work before I had the interview.
Wow. That's hard. That's ballsy. Wow.
Well, I was very new to the whole Free State Project. I literally found out about the Free State Project in May of 2011. I wanted to go to Pork Fest. I didn't go to Pork Fest. I left where I was living at the end of the week after Pork Fest and started looking for places in New Hampshire and work and all of that. And I moved in August. Like, it was like that. So I didn't know any of the stuff that, like, went on here. So I didn't know that, you know, people suggested that you maybe not tell people. I didn't care.
Well, I think there's been, like, a lot more drama between then when you arrived and when we have arrived.
No, because as soon as I got here, like, when I told Ian that that I told them, and, you know, that they already knew that I was a Free Stater, he's like, oh, wow. 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 That's great. And I'm like, why is this great? I don't understand. Huh. But so I had sent my resume up because I have experience in the industry. And I got a call back from the place that I had signed up to, the place that I work now. And the assistant manager called me and we were talking. And he's like, well, I'd like to set up a phone or a Skype interview. And I was like, actually, I was intending to come up to New Hampshire, you know, and check things out and all that. So I'd like to do an interview in person. And he asked me why I wanted to move up to New Hampshire. I was like, I want to move to New Hampshire for the Free State Project. And he didn't know what that was. So it was a week between that phone call and my interview. And in that week, they did some research and figured out that the Free State Project and what it was and all that. And we discussed it a little bit in the interview, and they asked me, well, are there any group meetings or anything that might restrict your schedule? And I kind of laughed, and I'm like, no, there's no. And then they told me a story. They're like, well, we don't see any problem with that. You know, we've never really, there are some Free Stater folks who come in here and do karaoke because that's like a thing, or at least it used to be. And we did have, we didn't really have a problem, but there's this guy one time who was open carrying, and we just had to ask him to leave. They were talking about Rich Paul.
Yeah, I'd imagine.
Aww.
So.
Yeah. But they ended up having to ask him to leave because someone complained about it, which a similar incident happened a couple years later during the first, or last year during the Keenvention. I had to ask Abel to put his gun out in the car because some people had complained about him drinking alcohol and having a firearm. Which is totally valid, and in that case, you know, I just followed what past managers would do and asked him to put in his car. He wasn't comfortable with that, so he left. Whatever.
Yeah.
Whatever.
It's understandable if you own the establishment to have that worry. Yeah.
Yeah, but I wouldn't. I have Googled myself.
Gross.
I know. And I'm actually not worried if someone actually Googles my name by itself. I have a common name, and there's a lot of there's like athletes and business people and stuff like that that have my name. Hell, there's a robertmathias.net that's not me. So there's like a bunch of people that have my name. I come up on like page 3 of Google or something like that. It's like far down. However, you put NH next to my name. Holy shit. Everything I've done since I got here. Everything. Like, everything's on there.
Have you Googled yourself, Cecelia?
Yeah, a picture of my grandma comes up.
Really?
I'm named after her.
Oh.
Yeah, she did this article once about business. So there's always a picture of her because my spelling of Cecelia is uncommon, which it's the correct way, C-E-C-E-L-A. That's correct. But it's normally spelled C-E-C-I. So whenever I Google myself, it's like, did you mean? And I'm like, no, motherfucker, I did not. So there's not a lot of Cecilias like that. There is Cecelia Earnhardt, who is a writer, but she spells it the other way. So it's always like, did you mean? I'm like, no, I didn't fucking mean that, bitch. But if you Google me, I come up. There's things. You get my bowling stats from like when I bowled at Father City High School and when I bowled in college. I like bowling.
You definitely find a lot of great content if you Google Shire Dude.
Correct. You know, my name kind of appeared in the last Shire Dude episode.
Yeah. How does it feel to have a Shire Dude episode almost named after you?
I felt so special.
You're now as special as Ash the Studio Cat.
Right.
Not only did I have
an episode half named Pedro.
Not only did I have an episode half named after me, but I had a 3-second clip.
There you go.
First appearance on a Shire Dude.
Oh, and I have so much Cecelia footage from Keenvention.
So not the last.
That's gonna come out of the woodwork.
Oh, goodness.
I'm really looking forward to the next Shire Dude episode.
Rob has submitted so much content for it, and I've got footage from Cecelia too. She's given me all this great old Keen footage that's like, it's like ancient. It's like looking through like history books at this point.
I recorded a lot my first year and a half here.
Yeah, and it's like 10 Shire years ago, so it's like, to me, it just blows my mind.
It's like historical documents.
Yeah, it's like, professor, day. It says it's from like 1952.
Like half of the people in the videos aren't even here.
Oh, that's like Libertopia.
Oh, the movie came out. I'm moving back to California. Okay, yeah. Bye, Andrew Carroll.
Oh.
See you later.
Is he coming back?
He literally moved like 2 weeks after I moved here.
Wow.
It was very, the time I moved here, it was very interesting. I moved and then Allie moved 2 weeks later and Andrew Carroll moved away. I was like, psh, Allie, that's your fault. Not really.
Let's blame Allie. It's okay.
Yeah, blame her.
I like blaming Allie for lots of things. It's fun.
Why?
I'm being facetious.
Oh.
I'm being silly.
So, what's the greatest thing that's ever happened because of you moving to the Shire?
Me moving to the Shire. No, not this. No, incorrect.
I was signaling that this is the greatest thing, being on the Rebel.
Yeah, right now. This is the best moment of your life right now, being on the show.
That is incorrect.
Oh.
I don't know if this isn't directly related, but it did happen while I was here. Two best things. Unequivocally, that I've ever, two best decisions I've ever made in my life. Number one, moving to New Hampshire with the Free State Project. And number two, getting laser eye surgery and correcting my vision. Two best things.
Oh,
which,
yeah.
You know.
When did you have that done?
In June, 2 weeks before Porkfest.
Okay. I never really talked to you much until, like, really Porkfest. Yeah.
There's
yeah.
a lot of new people here, and a lot of them don't even know that I used to wear glasses and used to be fat.
I talked to you before.
I mean, I know we used to talk on Facebook before you moved.
Yeah.
And, like, you were still kind of fat, and, like, we were friends, and then you stopped being fat, and then you moved here.
Speaking of, how did you lose it?
Low carb.
So did I.
I know.
Yeah. Yeah. Was it all just low carb, or did you do anything else?
I didn't work out at all. I lost 35 pounds.
Just doing low carb.
I did 1,200 calories a day, kept under 30 carbs. Yeah.
Did you have to make like a mental decision to stay on that diet?
Yes.
Or okay.
That is what I decided, that I wanted to lose 20 pounds before Porkfest, 6 weeks before Porkfest last year, Porkfest 10. I decided 6 weeks before I was going to lose 20 pounds before Porkfest. I did that, and then I lost an additional 15 pounds, and then I took my intake up to about 2,000 calories a day and just leveled off and just stayed constant. I'm going to drop it down again and lose some more. I want to lose probably another 20 to 30, and I think I'll be done.
You can do that in like a month or two.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I just have to do it. It's all about doing it and sticking
to
it. That's all it is.
I need to make a mental decision to actually work out a little bit and actually like tone. Because right now, like, I've been at this weight now, hovering around 180-ish, give or take, for the last year and a half now, almost 2 years. But I kind of want to, I don't know, I feel like I'm too skinny at the moment. I kind of want to get a little muscle mass, not much. I don't want to be bulky. I just need to, like, tone it. But I haven't made that mental decision.
I do need to tone a little bit. There's definitely a little toning.
Because I actually lost a lot of muscle losing weight. Like I actually lost
really?
A lot. Yeah. I was a lot stronger before. Well, like when I was a huge, because when you're really huge, I was like, I'm carrying all this weight. So like I felt a lot stronger than I do now. Mm. Yeah. Hmm. But I've been too lazy.
Maybe you should get fat again.
I don't want to get fat again. I hated it. I love like actually being mostly in shape. I still need to lose a little bit, but for the most part, I feel like I'm in shape. Yeah.
People who've been listening to the show for a while know that I'm going to do the all Soylent thing.
Yeah, when is that going to happen, man? when are you going to go full Soylent?
Like, and I mean a while, because...
In like 5 Shire
Dudes. I got a 4 to 6 week delay notice in the email, right? And then like 4 to 6 weeks later, I got another one. So something's going on.
Yo, dog, I heard you like a 4 to 6 delay.
Yeah.
So I got you a 4 to 6 week delay to go with your 4 to 6 week delay.
I call shenanigans on Soylent. So just know if you're going to order Soylent, it's going to take like 5 years to get it.
Does Neil or Matt still do Soylent?
I think Matt quit it.
I think Neil still does it. He sings its praises all the time.
Yeah.
I'm drinking my Soylent.
I can't wait, because I eat terribly right now, just because I don't have time to...
Yeah, I haven't seen you eat healthy since you got here.
Well, I don't have time to really, like, prepare meals, and I don't have, like, a full kitchen. Like, there's not a stove in the kitchen that's readily available to me. You know, I can go upstairs.
What do you mean there's not a stove readily available?
There's the stove upstairs, but I don't want to go upstairs to cook. Like,
why can't you use the stove down?
There's no stove downstairs.
There's a dishwasher.
There's a hot plate.
Yeah, use the hot
and
plate.
There's a hot plate. I'm not cooking my meals on a hot plate.
Dude, Peter can't even boil water on that shit.
It's terrible, yeah.
He's like, yeah.
I microwaved pasta today, okay? Like, that's where I am right now.
Oh, man, you gotta get your life together. Man. You gotta.
Well, I'm hoping that with Soylent, I have the convenience of not having to, you know, do these large preparations for meals.
Well, if you're gonna go Soylent, you gotta go full Soylent.
You never go full Soylent.
Well, you know, you can have your Starbucks coffee with it. So Starbucks coffee and Soylent.
Yeah.
Or mix it together. Have Starbucks flavored.
Well, I want to make a Soylent Frappuccino.
He doesn't drink coffee.
What?
No, you drink and not a drink.
I do drink a not a drink, but there's tons of caffeine in it.
Fucked that up. I'm sorry.
The not a drink is it's if you go to Starbucks you can get one, I guess. Can I give like the recipe right now?
Oh, sure, right. Go for it.
It's one pump of white mocha, right, over ice, with a dash of heavy cream, like a tiny tiny amount of heavy cream.
Not under it, over it.
Yeah, over ice with a tiny amount of heavy cream and 5 pumps of what's called Frappuccino roast is what gives a Frappuccino its caffeine
content. I love
content.
Frappuccino roast.
5 pumps will get you going. Like, that stuff's like crack.
Okay.
Yeah.
How many calories is that?
A lot.
That's like that calories? Sounds like, that sounds like 500 or 600 calories.
No. One pump of white mocha, like that's all the calories you're getting besides a heavy cream. That's like just a splash.
So the frappuccino dark.
The roast is it's like water and coffee. It's like, oh. Yeah, it's like a coffee concentrate. So it doesn't have a lot of calories. I think it does have a little bit of sugar, though.
Shire Dude changed my world. He changed my coffee world. He let me know that I've been ordering my Frappuccino all wrong.
Oh, yeah.
How do you order a all Frappuccino?
My Frappuccino choice would be I can't remember right now. Mocha Frappuccino. And I used to do 2 to 3 shots of espresso, depending on what kind of day it was.
Which is terrible.
Which is terrible because apparently the hot espresso shots water down the ice.
Yeah, they melt it.
Like, and then they make your drink all watery and soggy.
You want an ice blended beverage and you're putting boiling hot water into it. So, yeah.
So Shire Dude, being the Starbucks sage that he is, told me that I should do 6 or 7 or 7 or 8 Frappuccino roast pumps. Tell him to put that in there instead of the espresso. Oh, my God. My drink is nice and icy and cold and blended and delicious.
It's got an interesting flavor to it, too. So it's a different flavor.
So good.
You have to hook me up. I'm sold the Frappuccino.
The roast, man.
Roast. Yeah. You gotta have pumpkin in there, though.
Pumpkin? Instead of the white mocha, yeah. Although I'd recommend something a little sweeter with the pumpkin.
Why is
that? Like maybe a little vanilla bean powder. Because the pumpkin isn't very sweet compared to other syrups. And I like really sweet drinks.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I like pumpkin. I don't know. I'm addicted. I have a problem with pumpkin. I still drink pumpkin coffee. I've been drinking it now for like 3 months straight.
Well, it's fall.
I know.
Although
I love
it fucking feels like winter.
Oh,
feels
my
like
God.
Fucking January.
It was cold this last couple
fucking
of days.
Alaska. This is all Alaska's fault. I'm sorry. I like to swear a little bit. This is Alaska's fault. You know why this is Alaska's fault, right?
No.
Really?
No, I don't know why
do
this is Alaska's fault.
I know there's a big news thing. I forget what they're calling
it.
Do you
know there's a world out there?
actually, no. Since I moved here, I haven't paid attention to anything. Apparently, there's something going on with Buffalo, New York, and snow.
They got a lot of it or something.
Something with the president being a tyrant and people
like
are paying attention
right
now.
7 feet of snow.
Yeah, some snow, whatever.
No, like 7 feet of snow.
It's Buffalo, New York. They always get snow. How is this news?
But not 7 feet.
7 feet.
Yeah, they get that much snow.
Anyways, the reason the entire country, the entire geographical location known as the United States of America.
Thank you. I didn't know what you were talking about.
I wanted to clarify.
Good.
I used the real terms, not the double talk.
Good. That's what we do here.
This is how we do. So there was a tropical storm that went up the coast of California, but it overshot where they thought it was going to go. So it went all the way up the coast into Alaska. Which grabbed all the Arctic winds and forced it across the country. So that's why all the states are having really cold, shitty weather, and a lot of people have snow. Like in Colorado, it's 20 degrees. In Colorado.
It's Colorado, though. They get cold.
It's 20 degrees down in Virginia.
Okay. It shouldn't be 20 degrees in Virginia.
It's 20 degrees down in Florida.
Well, now they don't have an excuse not to live in New Hampshire.
They're all like, "Fuck New Hampshire! I'm going down to Florida. I want to be warm." Fucking Florida!
Oh man.
I'll be honest though, like I can't. I used to be able to handle cold weather very well, but ever since I lost my weight, I am freezing.
Yes.
Like correct. I am so freezing. I lost all my insulation. My extremities, my hands and my feet get freezing cold. Like freezing cold.
If you don't like it, move to Somalia.
I feel your pain, but I'm gonna one up you here right now.
Okay.
My vehicle does not have heat. So not only did I lose all my padding and all my nice warmness, but I don't have heat in my car, so I use blankets.
You drive around with blankets. Yes. Are you driving around with one of those blankets?
It's not a snuggie.
The snuggies?
I have my snuggie at home.
You should have a car snuggie specifically just for driving.
No, but no, it's just my legs because I wrap myself. I normally wear a hoodie and then a jacket over top of it. So it's not the upper layer of me. It's my legs and my feet that get cold. So I use the blankets on my legs. Otherwise, I would probably be a popsicle. I would not be able to make the commute from Keene to Manchester. That's for fucking sure.
I had I remember one time I was driving Rich out to Manch from Keene. I think it was actually for this episode, and we almost crashed twice because it was in a snowstorm. And
when was this?
This was like back in the beginning of April. and it was still okay. it was a small icy snowstorm. It wasn't like huge.
Because didn't you just have him on like recently?
Yes.
Okay.
It was his second appearance on the show.
I was so about to say it hasn't snowed yet. Jesus.
Well, he was in jail. What do you want me to do? He was in jail for a while, so he couldn't be on the show. So.
Oh, is he taking Joel's place?
Is Rich Paul taking Joel's place?
Yeah, you know, he used to do a podcast with Bo Davis for like an episode and a half.
I heard it was three episodes, no?
No, it was literally like an episode and a half.
Oh, was it really?
He actually has a really good idea for a podcast. But
you know,
honestly,
Rich Paul
has
lots
happen.
Of really good ideas.
He has great ideas, but he never follow. The only thing he can follow through with is a 420 rally.
Oh.
Correct.
I need to follow that guy around, though, with like a pad and paper. And I have been a little bit.
He had this great idea to do like a That 70s Show style like YouTube/podcast show where it would just go to different camera angles, just like how I'm switching camera angles right now. But whenever someone's talking, it's like it would go to them smoking and then talking. And then as soon as it would be like in a circle,
like the smoking room in the 70s show.
Yeah,
the smoke in the garage.
But as a Liberty / you know, pot pro pot podcast with Rich Paul, I'd watch it. It'd
I think
be a good
I think we should take all of the things that have already been done and then repackage them as Liberty things.
Like
and
what?
All the things.
All the things.
All
yeah,
the things.
Anything could be the Liberty this or Liberty that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Like just yep, all the things.
I would like to see a Big Lebowski as a Free State Project. Some whatever.
What?
How would that work?
We believe in nothing.
Well, we already have. We got, you know, Ofer can be Saddam, so we got that working for us. You know, I don't know. I would like to see some more Liberty content that's not activist footage.
We already got the dude, so you know.
We got the dude abides right over here.
I would like better quality media content.
I mean, better than this?
I'm just saying more well-produced media content. I hate quick and dirty stuff. Like,
yeah.
If you're going to put something out there and put your name on it, and, like, because to me, like, reputation and, like, your name and shit, like, if I'm putting my name on something, it's going to be the best it can possibly be, Shire Dude. Because it speaks about me. It speaks about who I am as a person, my work ethic, you know, the things that I'm able to do and create and produce. And I want it to be the best quality, whatever it is I'm doing. Whatever I'm doing, I want it to be the best I can do.
Yeah. Well, no, I definitely think there needs to be some sort of higher end, like higher quality, like almost Hollywood, like production value on like some sort of content that I can't even think of that exists yet. Like something that I don't want to be just pure activist footage. I want it to be like... It doesn't
so
have
like,
to be a talk show. It can be, I don't know, like maybe an acting or
you want
a
new
skit
kind
show
of show.
There's something new that hasn't been done
so
yet.
So many shows like this. There's so many shows like, you know, just what's out there already. Like the Google Hangout show. We don't need another show of you doing Google Hangouts with your Liberty friends.
That's why.
Please stop.
That's why this show is not a Google Hangout show. I will never have
such
a
poor
Skype
quality.
In or a Google Hangout on this show ever. It will never happen. Because there's so many people in the community to come up as guests on here. Why am I going to do a Hangout show on Google Hangouts when I can do it in person?
Exactly.
There's too many fucking podcasts.
I don't think there's enough,
many,
actually.
There's too many podcasts, and I swear to Christ, if people do not stop inviting me to events about their podcasts.
Yeah, but those podcast invites, which I used to do, but we actually did broadcast it live for a few weeks, and then we're like, fuck that. That's
wicked
much
annoying.
Work. Oh, you're dropping some local slang on us.
Oh, I like linguistic type stuff, so I appropriate words all the time. I've moved around a number of times in my life, so
but
I have
words.
Yeah,
but you can't say wicked annoying because wicked is supposed to be something good.
No, wicked is a qualifier. Exactly what he said.
Okay.
So it could be good, it could be bad, you could use it in any context. It is to amplify what you were describing. So that's a
or to talk about witches.
Yes, exactly. Like this guy has a wicked good haircut.
His hair is actually starting
awesome
to come
shirt.
Along. His hair, like, don't change your
I'm
hair.
I'm just trying to get back to 101 Reasons levels.
Yeah, that was like, you know, Conan O'Brien level hair you had going on.
It was moving
there.
And shaking, and it was like a character. It should have got a credit.
By
next
the
to my
way,
name.
Like, you could tell that in that video that was recorded, like, you know, 2 years ago, Shire time, because...
Right.
You looked, your personality in that was so fucking different. Like, so different. I didn't recognize you in that. Like, you seemed, I don't know if I can put.
Do you want me to explain like what was going through my mind?
As absolutely.
Okay, so first of all, a little admission: I was really stoned when I did that interview, and then the other thing that was going through my mind was I was really nervous because Bo has got like his fancy professional lights and camera set up. You know, I'm like I got a wearable microphone, and he's Bo freaking Davis. I mean, this is the guy who made the movie that triggered my move. So you know, I was still a little starstruck.
You were starstruck a lot when you got here.
I didn't have that.
No, you didn't get starstruck?
I was a new Liberty baby. Like I had literally only learned what a libertarian was in May, shortly before I found Free Talk Live and the Free State Project. I had been a libertarian for a long time, but I didn't know that there was a word and there were people who believe. I just thought I was a weird conservative.
You just moved really quickly then.
Yes. Wow. I went from being a minarchist to an anarchist within 2 weeks of moving.
That would do that living here.
Yes.
Absolutely.
Yes, it does.
Yeah. It was kind of crazy because we literally recorded an episode yesterday, which probably won't go up for a couple of weeks, just like this episode, just because I'm kind of a slacktivist to get it actually uploaded. But at any rate, Allie was talking about how she was like, had like fangirl moments, like she had people that like she idolized that she met when she moved here.
I witnessed them.
Yeah. Well, do tell. What was an instance in which you witnessed her have a fangirl moment?
Oh goodness, let me think. Her meeting Ian was pretty exciting because she had been listening to Ian for a long time, and then when he asked her to start being on Free Talk Live, she was very taken back. Let's see. There's someone, Bob Murphy. When she met Bob Murphy at Porkfest when she met Bob Murphy, it was so adorable. She was definitely like starstruck, and like they talk all the time now, but it was so adorable, so adorable.
Yeah, it was actually kind of heartwarming that she like she did that when she moved, because I mean I listened to Free Talk Live for years, like years, so I knew who Allie Havens was because she was on Free Talk Live, and I actually used to watch, remember way back in the day when they had like the FreeKeene like news videos. Remember, I don't know if you guys know what I'm talking about.
They tried to do
a news show, and Allie and Derek were like
FreeKeene TV. Were,
yeah, FreeKeene TV. Yeah, so I
that
actually
was all JJ.
Yeah, I know. Yeah. So I actually used to watch that and whatnot, and I for the episode last night, I remember looking at. I think Allie asked me like, you know, did she asked something along the lines of like, did you watch this stuff or whatnot? Did you know who we are? It's like with her and Brett. I'm like, yeah. I knew exactly who you guys were before I moved. Like I knew a lot. I knew who you were before I
and
moved. Not
Cecilia,
because we were talking, because I actually used to listen. I listened to an episode of Ladies and Keen before I moved.
Just one.
Just that was all I needed to listen to. No offense.
I was gonna say.
Wait. Who was on when you listened? Because we went through a lot of different dynamic changes. A lot, because there was...
I don't know. This was like 3 years ago or 2 years ago.
Dude, it went from... Allie was first chair, and I was second chair, and Kate was third, and Kate never talked. And then Allie went to go do Adam Kukesh's show. I took first chair, and then Shauna came on, and then Julie was on for a while. And there's just so many different... And then Ellen came on. There's just so many different dynamics going on. So it's quite possible that you listened to a very shitty show. We had a couple gems, but there were a number of shows where there's just long drags of... Yeah. But Garrett Fox is a fan, so therefore winning. And I had someone ask me to take a picture with them once. That was cool.
Wow.
for being on a show that like only had like 76 episodes. We ran for like a year and a half, and we were on after Off the Air Live on Saturdays. So like an hour after Free Talk Live ended. That's when we were on.
So wait, how many episodes did you do of
six,
of that?
76.
Damn. And was it a weekly show?
Yes. We started, we did Sunday mornings at 11 a.m. God, I don't know why. For like the first 8 months. And then we switched over to Saturday nights. Or maybe it was like 6 months. And then we switched over to Saturday nights.
Why did you give it up?
Why? Sundays?
No, why did you give up the show?
Well, I wanted to start producing videos because I'm like a total package. You have to like see and hear and all the things. It's not just one.
Yeah, like this is a podcast and it's also on YouTube. Hey guys, how's it going?
Yeah, but I wanted to do targeted videos like with topics and just talk about things. That didn't quite happen because I do this thing called a job. Like I work 40 hours a week, so I actually took quite a bit of a break from producing content and doing activism and even a lot of social things. I just kind of took a break from everything for a while. And then this year after Porkfest, I started coming back out to Manchester a lot. And I had this idea, and I talked to Carla, and she told me, she hooked me with the Vol people. And I was like, you know what? You know who'd be really good on this? Shire Dude. So I talked to Shire Dude, and now we're making art babies.
So when's speaking of art babies, when's the next episode of Shire Dude?
Oh, because that is kind of like all of our art baby, right? This is the long, like, arduous one that I know it's gonna take the longest to edit. Oh man,
are you gonna put that clip that I sent you from that TV show that I told you about?
All the clips.
That is gonna be the.
I'm pretty sure I have that clip downloaded. Yeah. Okay.
But it's gonna be in something soon, right?
The next episode.
Oh, good.
Hopefully.
Is the next one the one that you told me about before, the reason I sent you all those clips?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I know. And so that's, I don't want to give away too much on the air because it's fantastic.
Okay, one more question. Are you going to put grandma in it?
Put what?
Grandma.
Grandma?
Grandma.
Grandma.
Shauna.
What are we talking
It was your
about?
Favorite clip.
I think so.
Oh, good Lord.
I don't think he knows what the fuck you're talking
about. Yeah, no. I think, no. The,
Do
what
you
she's
listen
about,
to me?
Where she's talking
how is this supposed to work if you don't communicate?
Don't you
how know? Are we supposed to make the art babies if you can't even communicate your wants and needs to me?
It's the really short clip, right?
Short clip.
Yes, you know what? I know what you're talking about.
You gonna go sit in the corner now?
Yeah. I'm just gonna roll over here.
Okay. Well, anyways, we're gonna cut the show off because it's coming up on the hour mark anyway. So, where can people find you at, Cecelia? Where are you at?
I'm in New Hampshire.
Oh, obviously.
Well, I don't really have anything or any kind of place. You can catch the show It's Like This Too.
And maybe we'll figure out the URL sometime after this recording.
Facebook.com/It's Like This Too or freestateproject.org.
Oh, well, that works, actually. I was referring to the YouTube channel. Wait, there's a Facebook page for It's Like This Too?
Yes.
Yes. That's where we'll be releasing the bloopers. If Shire Dude ever makes any more.
I've been collecting bloopers.
Yeah. Okay, why don't you produce some of this?
Because I have a slow-ass laptop.
Well, this is division of labor, too.
Yes, I do all the interviewing. I ask all the questions. I set up all the interviews.
So basically, he's just like a little... He's the bitch that just does everything for you.
No, I get all the
Whoa.
Information, and he makes it pretty.
Whoa, you can't... Oh, hold on.
This is what it's like. It's like in volleyball, where I volley it. I toss it up, and he smacks that bitch over.
I'm spiking it, yo.
He's spiking shit.
You recover that well. I'll give you that much.
I'm very good at what I do.
But you can edit you can put out the bloopers. How hard is that? You have access to it, I would assume. Just upload it. How hard is that?
No,
take?
Well,
hit a
I
button
actually,
on a computer.
No, I make the bloopers while I make the episode.
Oh.
So it's like I'm editing two videos at once.
I have no idea how your guys' relationship
works. Yeah, you just cut out the funny bits while you're going along and then move them somewhere else, and then they're all collected and ready to go, and then you just slap them together.
Okay.
Yeah, the bloopers make themselves.
FreeStateProject.org. Go check out It's Like This Too.
Yeah. And, yeah.
Shire Dude, where are people going
to
find
you? Here's what you want to do. You want to wait a good 2 weeks for me to finish this episode and then go to ShireDude.com.
By the time this episode comes out,
it should
will
be, out.
Be out.
Okay, so
Hopefully.
That'll be my deadline. Go to ShireDude.com. It'll be right up there on the front for you. There you go.
There you go. All right. And also, you have a whole bunch of extra content for It's Like This Too, right?
Yeah, yeah. From the 101 Reasons movie.
Yeah.
Is that what you're talking about?
Yeah.
Bo says he's going to give me, Bo Davis, he was talking
about.
The
full archive.
Giving me his archive. And actually, he was talking about uploading all of his footage to the internet so other people can go in and tweak the videos and make their own videos about the Free State Project.
So he's going
to
do a raw 101.
I would love for that to happen. That's just beautiful B-roll that he has. That's
oh, yeah.
Just
he has a shit ton of content.
I'm sure he has people bustling. He
bustling.
Probably has so much bustling.
We need a bustling.
He's all about the bustling.
Montage. I wanted a bustling montage to be the beginning of It's Like This Too. And instead, I have like the little kind of like animated thing that I did. But
yeah, I'm totally going to redo that graphic to like be pretty and like movable things. You should have told me that you wanted to move. I could have done pieces for you instead of you.
Oh, that'd be
taking
so much
it,
easier.
Instead of you taking it into paint and like fading out the, like circling it and fading. I know exactly what you did when I was like, oh,
I didn't
and
do
did
that.
This. And yep. Uh-huh.
I didn't do that in paint.
Oh, Really?
Yeah. Because
I thought you did everything in paint.
I do a lot of image work in paint, but no, I did that in Cyberlink Power Director, where I put a mask over each one.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's like four different or five different layers that you're looking at.
Yeah.
I'm very good at editing videos.
I'm very good at making things pretty.
What are you good at, Rob?
I'm good at doing a podcast, which you can find at rebelloveshow.com. You can also find my content at vrebel.com. And go like us on Facebook. And also, of course, go subscribe to us on YouTube. And maybe download us on iTunes and Stitcher.
And maybe donate a mil of it if you liked listening to my voice.
Yeah, give me some Bitcoin. Give Shire Dude here some Dogecoin. And do you take coins? Do you even take coins?
Just pay me some attention.
And pay Cecelia some attention.
Attention coin coming this fall.
There you go. And we're out, kids. Peace.
Peace.
V for vagina.
And we're out. Yeah.
Did it bug you more or less than the employees at the Best Western during Keenvention while they were moving things around and we were shooting? More or less?
That's the same agitation, so I think it bugged me exactly the same. Although there were two of them. So.
There were two of them, and they were moving things, actively moving things.
Yeah,
they
didn't have to immediately move.
They did apologize, though.
They did. Mm-hmm. So, I don't know. I don't know if that absolves them.
I don't think it does.
Yeah.
All right, you kids ready?
I was born ready, fool.
Were you?
That's what I learned from Full Metal Jacket.
Oh.
That right. And Me Love You Long Time and something about Jugheads.
Well, it looks like you learned the important stuff.
All the important things.
All the important things. Okay.
That's a cat.
Yeah, it's Ash. She's Ash the studio cat. She's actually the producer of this show. She's the one that posts all the episodes on the website.
It's a fucking talented cat.
Oh, she is.
Fucking.
She's the admin of the website.
I'm sure fucking Bubbles would love to meet her. I love that kitty.
Bring her.
Fucking Bubbles. I love my kitties.
Is that how Bubbles sounds?
Yes.
Really?
Trailer Park Boys? Never watched? No?
No.
Oh. It's Canadian. It's hilarious. And there's a character. And then like this. And there's Bubbles. And those fucking kitties.
Yeah, I didn't see it. I've seen a hell of a lot of TV, but I have not seen that.
It's very interesting. There's like 8 seasons and 3 movies.
No shit.
Yes. It's on Netflix.
I'll probably never get to it. Maybe in a couple years.
It's unfortunate. It's funny. It's really funny. I mean, Bubbles even raps about his kitties.
Oh.
Yep.
I'll have to try to find the rap on like YouTube or something. Okay, ready? Ready to get the shindig on the road here? I'm asking you.
Oh.
Are you ready?
Oh, yeah. Wait, hold on.
Okay, I'll wait.
Fix your hair.
I just had to get my hair's messed up.
When is your hair ever not messed up?
Perfect.
Thank you.
Perfect.
You need to get to where you're like the fonts and you just don't even touch it. You're like, and
but then he has to hit things. You know, jukeboxes.
That violates the jukebox nap.
Don't violate the nap, Carl.
God, there needs to be better Liberty memes nowadays. There's
I'm
no
trying.
Good ones anymore.
I'm trying, man.
No, you. Well, I don't think you're ever gonna beat the Daryl one.
Sleepy time.
The sleep.
Oh my God.
He still
art.
Posts about sleeping.
He still does.
And I like that. I like when he does. And I know.
I like it.
I
like it every time he does. Every time he talks about sleeping, I make sure I like it.
I'm actually not friends with Daryl on Facebook anymore. He had me blocked for a while.
What? Oh.
Yeah.
I'm not surprised.
That he had me blocked.
Daryl gets upset.
He does.
Very easily.
Yeah.
He screamed at me at Porkfest on stage in front of like a couple hundred people.
Wait, what did he say?
Daryl?
Yeah.
Was it during a panel?
I don't remember this.
I was doing the Family Feud. We were the podcast-inators.
Mm-hmm.
I was doing it with... Garrett and Annie, yes. Is that their names? Yeah. And
Garrett Fox,
yes.
Annie Catherine, yes.
Yes.
They're amazing people.
They're absolutely beautiful, mm-hmm. amazing people. Yeah. And I tried to say something funny, like the questions were like, "What is New Hampshire famous for?" And I was like, "Dunkin' Donuts." He's like, "It's snow. Why did you say snow? That was the right answer." And we lost because of that. It really was snow. Snow was the answer.
To be fair, I watched the Family Feud thing during Porkfest, and at least you did better than the New York people.
Oh God, they were sitting right next to us the whole time, super drunk.
I swear, if they could come up with an answer that wasn't mechanic or massage therapist, they might have had a chance.
Yeah,
because they said both those answers twice. Like, are you not even listening to the people next to you? And the one drunk bitch was humping people.
Yeah, I know.
Did you see that?
I did see that. Yeah, she humped Daryl. She definitely humped Daryl.
She humped some old lady. I don't know the girl's name, but she was a volunteer and she came over to like explain the rules to them. And she just started humping her, yeah. And the girl was like,
and
"Oh my god!"
She's wearing like nothing but a t-shirt when she was doing
it.
Yeah,
like a bikini underneath.
Yeah,
and then she's like smoking the pavilion. And someone's like, "Hey, you're not supposed to smoke in here. I'm an anarchist. I don't follow rules." Like, no, this is just common decency.
Wasn't it? What's her name was on the on their team too? The person running for Senate in New York.
Gigi Bowman.
Yeah.
So this is really funny. So Gigi Bowman was supposed to be on the team. It was her team, right? But the drunk humping chick, I believe her name was Tiffany. I'm not entirely sure about that. She was the alternate, and she went up on stage and sat down in a seat before Gigi could sit down. So then Gigi, there's like this awkward moment, and then Gigi just got off the stage, and she was so livid at the end when they lost. Oh my god, she like was freaking out on them. It was hilarious.
I walked past. So I walked past the Gigi Bowman tent at one point, and someone said something about. I think I was walking with Graham, and he said something about Cantwell to her, and she just like flipped her shit.
Oh, right, she hates
like,
him.
It was like me and Joelle like walking. I'm like, let's go back to Agoura Valley. I'm not even dealing with this. Like, I don't even give a shit about that. Like, you know, and yeah, she like freaked out, about it. Like, she loves that him for some reason. Like, it was. Ooh,
oh,
bizarre.
She loves him? Last time I checked, she hated him.
Cantwell?
Yeah.
I don't know. She was like screaming about how I've known him for 15 years and how, you know, he's a great guy and I don't understand why people here don't like him. Blah, 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 like screaming at the top of her lungs, like with her arms wailing in the air.
That had to be entertaining.
It was. I almost wanted to tape it.
I would like pay a nickel
record
to watch
it.
That.
Yeah, I almost
nickel.
Wanted to record it, and then I was like, "Nah, this is
micropayments."
Ooh, micropayments. Is that like microaggression?
It's like it's more like micropenis.
Is it like this too?
Yes.
You know, it'd be like this too if we actually started the show instead of just did 8 minutes of content with not actually doing the show.
This was great.
It's a pre-show.
No, don't get me wrong. I've been recording it, so it'll probably there's sound bites I'm gonna use. It'll probably be like bonus material, maybe at the end or at the beginning.
Yeah, there's this
like
drunk
that.
Bitch.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. I'm starting the show now, kids. All right.